Good evening, everyone. We're going to get started promptly, so thank you for coming tonight. My name is Darren Sievers, and I'm your MC tonight, or your moderator. I'm the superintendent of the Slinger School District, so the topic that we're going to discuss tonight is near and dear to my heart. I used to be, actually my first job in Slinger 22 years ago was as a high school guidance counselor working with our at-risk youth. And so anything we can do to make the road to adulthood and the adult world a safer, happier place for kids in this county is important to me. So I'm going to get started and introduce our program tonight. I want to welcome you to Celebrating Recovery and Legislation, where we'll hear from a panel of people who are struggling with addiction and from a Wisconsin legislator on changes being made at the state level. Tonight is the fourth of a five-part lecture series to educate parents and other adults in Washington County on the dangers of opiate addiction in Washington County. This is a cooperative effort of the West Bend Rotary, Elevate, Moraine Park Technical College, and the Washington County Heroin Task Force. This series is designed to complement the Hidden in Plain Sight exhibit, which we encourage you to visit later this evening. It's open until 8 o'clock. More details on additional lectures and the Hidden in Plain Sight exhibit will be available at the end of the program tonight. We'd like to start with a poem by Serenity Krieger, who lost her sister to addiction last year.
Hi, my name is Serenity Krieger. I am 16 years old and go to West Bend West High School. I'm a normal teenage girl who likes to hang out with friends, spend lots of time on my cell phone, work a part-time job, and I love doing makeup. In the past 4 years, I have become very involved in our local community in its fight against the current drug epidemic, especially heroin. Some of the events I've attended included being invited to a legislative breakfast where our drug issues were discussed with government officials. I've spoken and presented at a peers-to-peers event and shared information about my addiction or about my sister's addiction to kids my age. In October of 2015, I attended a weekend-long opiate heroin summit by the Wisconsin Department of Justice in Wisconsin Dells. I am also currently the president of STAND, Students Taking Action, Not Drugs, and you also may have seen me at one of the local heroin rallies holding up my sign. Today I'm here to read to you a special poem that was written by someone very close to me. She wrote it while in treatment for her own addiction. She wanted to share how powerful her disease had become, and the addiction does not discriminate. I'm honored to be able to read her thoughts to you tonight. What does addiction look like? The picture I'm about to draw is not pretty. At 19 years old, I didn't look like a junkie. I had never been to an inner city or met a real drug dealer before. Yet I still lay in a hospital bed fighting for my life. No, I had not overdosed or drank too much. I had a blood clot in my lung. How could this happen, you may think? You are young and healthy. What you don't know is I've been getting heroin from a friend in my middle-class suburban neighborhood. The same exact trail you bike or walk your dog on, I have bought heroin there. With heroin comes needles, and with needles comes infection. I ended up with an infection in my arm where I would shoot up. It gnawed at my skin, my tissue, my flesh. It put me in the hospital bed, unable to bend my extremely swollen arm full of tiny poke holes. As I lay in this hospital bed, drowsy from my usual cocktail of benzos and sleeping meds, an idea came to mind. I'll have a visitor come to see me in the hospital. Nothing is suspicious or out of place, as it is just a hippie-looking teen boy. But this boy has brought me a present. This boy is my dealer, and he has brought me heroin. I unplug my IV pole and drag it to the hospital bathroom with my one functioning arm. I spend a whole 5 minutes in the bathroom plotting on how to get this poison into my IV. I decide it is impossible and chop it up along with Xanax, Vicodin, I cheek from the hospital nurse. I take a dollar bill and inhale. I was 19 in my hospital room poisoning myself. This is addiction, not just a junkie passed down in a ghetto on the street. Addiction will thrive anywhere, even in me, the good girl from suburbia. The poem I just read was written by my sister Dakota Krieger. I have watched her fight her own battle with addiction for the past 4 years. On September 7th, 2016, at around 12:20 a.m., I was awoken by my dad to come downstairs. There I found my mom and two police officers. I learned that my sister had earned her angel wings earlier that night. Her battle with addiction had come to an end. My sister was my best friend. Life will never be the same, and I will never be the same. Addiction is a disease, and it can happen to anyone, just like Dakota said. Today is the time we do something about this epidemic. Tomorrow is too late. Again, my name is Serenity, and I'm the sister of an addict whose life ended way too soon due to her disease of addiction. Thank you.
Thank you for that. Our next presenter is Representative Bob Gannon. Bob was elected to the Assembly in 2014. He was born in Mequon and is married with two children. He graduated from West Bend East High School in 1977, attended various colleges and vocational schools. Bob has been the proud owner of an independent insurance agency, hotel and investment properties. He's the member of the following organizations: the West Bend Sunrise Rotary, where he was president; Family Promise of Washington County, former president of that organization; West Bend Economic Development, former vice president; Stillwaters United Methodist Church; Independent Insurance Agents of Wisconsin; Professional Insurance Agents of Wisconsin, NRA; West Bend Chamber of Commerce, former president; former member of the West Bend JCs, where he was president; Washington County Youth Hockey Association president. And he currently serves on committees that include the Committee on Children and Families, where he's the Vice Chair; Committee on Corrections; Committee on Insurance; Committee on State Affairs; Committee on Urban Revitalization, where he's the Chair. And Bob and I do some business based on schools and school funding and some of those impacts in Madison as well. And so I would like to give a warm welcome to Representative Bob Gannon.
Thank you, Darren. Yeah, Darren and I have been able to work together on some school issues, and I was pleased to hear that he was here working on this issue as well. I forgot my resume was so long, but it doesn't mean anything when you get in a group like this, because you can throw all that stuff in the garbage and we have to have a different conversation. Yesterday at the Children and Family Committee, we heard about the CBD oil, and some in the legislature kept interrupting. CBD oil is... It's the oils from marijuana without the THC, basically, and it's used for children with seizures. And because of the drug issues, it's been a long time, the illegal drug issues, it's been a long time getting it passed. Well, there's some in the legislature that believe that full-blown marijuana should be legal in the state of Wisconsin instead of just making the non-catching a buzz oil available for sick children. And that's some of the things that happen, and it makes it difficult sometimes to get legislation passed. John Nygren is the chair, actually co-chair, of the Joint Finance Committee, and that means he helps spend the 70-some billion dollars every 2 years for the state of Wisconsin. John has a daughter that's a heroin addict, and John was invited to be here to speak, and John has been the main leader or impetus in the state assembly for these drug bills, the HOPE agenda. John told me the other day, as I was asking him how this is going and preparing for today, and he told me in a very truthful manner, he doesn't know that his daughter will be with him forever. It's the true heroin story. Will she stay sober long enough to live and grow up and be an adult? She's a young adult now. The HOPE agenda started in 2013, 2014, and there's been a lot of legislation passed. There's actually a whole alphabet of bills here. I'll hit off on a couple of them. But I think what you may find is some of this legislation that was passed is actually passed because the parents or the loved ones of those impacted by the opiates and the drugs have come forward and said this is a way people are beating the system and getting the drugs, or why they're not being caught with them, or things of that nature. My notes here talks about the amount of money we spend on the drug war. War is a bad term. How much we're fighting to have this battle with addiction. It's actually a small amount versus what it actually costs. The cost of addiction is costing the state of Wisconsin and the taxpayers. It's a very, very expensive problem. Thus, sometimes you have to invest money in order to stop the problem and get the finances back under control. Some of the bills that were in the last year's agenda was the Wisconsin Prescription Monitoring Program. I don't know, I think some of you may know about this, where basically physicians have to report when they're giving out opiates. So somebody cannot doctor shop and get additional drugs from extra physicians. law enforcement is uploading the information from, they have to upload it to the PDMT also. The pain clinics, we added extra regulations on the pill mills, the pain clinics, where people could go in and get extra drugs. Let's just take a look at some of the bigger ones. Narcan availability, we really stepped up where Narcan can be. Anybody can buy Narcan and have it available now. So we've made that much more available. Money we gave to the Department of Justice, something on the Department of Justice. When Brad Schimmel got elected to be your Attorney General 2 years ago, I called him immediately after I first got elected and got inaugurated after Chief Moyler from the West Bend Police Department told me about the problem that we lost the drop-off boxes for old prescriptions. You could no longer drop your pills off from your house and get them out of the house at secure locations. And within a couple of months, Brad Schimmel had that program back up and operating. And to tell you, show you how fast these things can move, Schimmel told me straight out, he says, I don't care if I have to talk to funeral homes and have them use the incinerators and funeral homes to get these drugs gone. These drugs are going to be gone. And he actually made a deal with, take you a little bit further, the reason that the prescription drugs were not being picked up any longer is that the incinerator did not meet DNR rules. So we had opiates in homes because we were afraid we were going to put a little pollution in the air, but we had kids ingesting the drugs instead. But that problem solved. Methadone clinics, we're keeping track of them to see if they're working, and they have to report out to find out what does actually work. That's fine. Here's what we got now. The governor has called a special session of the legislature, and what that means is the priority. It's putting the priority on the HOPE agenda. These are the bills that are coming out right now. Some of them are going to be more controversial, which means you should, if you like them, get a hold of your legislator or any legislator and tell them to support them. The Schedule 5 prescription prohibition, I didn't even know this was still available, but obviously there's still some cough syrups out there that have codeine in them. This would make it that the only way you're going to get those in the future is with a prescription. Treatment and diversion programs, the TAD program, I'm a big fan of this. Unfortunately, Washington County is not the biggest user of the TAD program. Thank you to Judge Martins that he's stepped up and actually put in extra time to get what we do have going actually working. But Washington County did receive additional drug and diversion program money. And the idea here is not to just lock up people that are arrested with a drug-related offense or where the drugs or the alcohol caused the problem. It's to get them treatment and get them to change their lifestyle, so hopefully we can break the cycle. So Washington County is actually coming up more, and the financing has been increased and will be increased more. This one is kind of big. And as a parent or a loved one, you probably think it's a great idea, but it's going to be a real it's going to be a nightmare in the legislature. There's a bill out now, and I think it's Section 51 of the state statutes. Any attorneys in the room? It's where you can take voluntarily commit somebody to basically take them off the street and lock them up in a secure facility. You can do it now for somebody with alcohol, and it's used very, very infrequently. It's when somebody's detoxing off of alcohol, they can die coming off of alcohol. Now, I'm told that is not the case with some of the opiates. But this law would be that you could still put somebody in a hold for up to 72 hours and basically clean them up. I don't know what's going to happen in the legislature. It's hard to pass legislation where you're basically committing somebody without due process, shall we say. But that is one of the things that has been recommended, and there's a bill out there to have that conversation. Addiction medicine consultation program is coming through. Department of Justice is getting more grants and more money, which means hope we can break the pipeline a little more. Training grants for addiction, mental health training is part of this. Okay, the probation, revocation, immunity. This is, we're expanding. Right now, if somebody called, we passed the law, I believe it was the last session. It may have been the session before. We passed the law that if you call and get help for somebody that's overdosing on drugs, that you will not be criminally prosecuted for that. This is actually, every time you pass legislation, you find out, oops, you know. So what this does is it takes it a step further. So if somebody's actually under the Department of Corrections already, their probation or their parole doesn't get revoked if they call in and help somebody, because there's a gap here where some people could still be, so the call would not be made to get help to somebody in a crisis. That one, additional opioid treatment programs. Let's see. Okay, recovery charter school. What this is we're hoping to fund a charter school for high schoolers that come through treatment, get cleaned up, and then don't feel they can go back into their own school. They would have a school available that better fits the needs of somebody that's cleaned up their life and wants to finish their education. So there would be a special charter school for people that have gone through recovery. That's fine. So that's pretty much the legislation that's coming through. All I can tell you is, you know, this is a very expensive problem, and it's a problem that has the legislature's focus. We obviously know very well what's going on. But I'm not a dummy. I know what's going on out there in the street. This is everywhere. There's no part of the state of Wisconsin that's not impacted by the drugs. I hear from my outstate legislator friends that some of it's more the meth than the other drugs than it is the opiates. It's kind of like pockets of what's going on. I do understand the power of addiction. I am an alcoholic myself. I don't go out advertising it, but I am a sober alcoholic, so I got some background on how this goes. No. I just say that because I think I want to tell you something, and here's the reality of it, is the people in here have been through this, and you, I have your back when I'm in the legislature, because I understand how hard it is for those around, as it was hard for people around me, to straighten somebody up and tell them to change their life and get on the right path. Tough love is the best thing for an addict. And I know how hard that is to watch somebody suffer and go through withdrawals and be a total jerk and be mad at you and be mean at you. But if you don't have the tough love, somebody's never gonna get cleaned up. Now I'm gonna say something else that'll probably get me in trouble by some people, but too bad. I've been known to be a little outspoken. I truly believe that if somebody doesn't have faith in a higher power, they're never gonna break this addiction. And here's my story, is I thought I was so damn smart that I didn't need help from anybody else. And the truth is, without having something that you believe in, whether it's your God or Allah or the fly on the wall, you're just not gonna be able to do it, man. And it's been proven over and over and over again. And I hope that the government, we can get them to believe that not every program is a government program, and that there are resources that have been designed and built outside of the government, and some of them with a faith-based basis that could be a good example for others. I got a minute here, and the committee I'm gonna be chairing is Urban Revitalization, and it's the same thing. We're gonna go in there and we're gonna hear stories, crime, drugs, things that are happening, and we're looking for the same thing that I assume you are, and that's answers to those problems, and those problems so often can be outside of your government. And so if you have answers that of what you've seen that works, like this program here that's put on by the Rotary Club, I'd love to hear about them, and I'd love to stand on the floor of the State Assembly and tell people that the government's not always the answer. There's great stuff happening that maybe we need to help support and get better results out of. So, questions or just move on?
Okay, we're going to invite our panelists to come up, and then we'll introduce them one at a time while this video plays.
to what I have to say. It's been a long time since you've been trying to figure out what you want. And if you haven't figured out what you want by now, just
the choice you make today can change the rest of your life. You have to make the choice yourself. I am here to help you. Don't walk away. Just listen to what I have to say.
Listen to what I have to say. It's been a long time since you've been trying to figure out what you want.
Okay, I would like to thank Representative Gannon for that candor, too. I think it takes a lot of strength, a lot of courage for him to self-disclose his own struggles with addiction, because it's one thing to stand up here and be an important Wisconsin governmental leader and pretend like it's not something that he can relate to. So for him to say, you know what, been there, done that, I think maybe that's it gives some strength to our panelists who are taking a big risk tonight and tell them their stories. I'd like to thank all the panelists and Representative Gannon for being willing to share what you're about to share with us, because again, it's these individual anecdotal stories that can give strength to an audience like we have tonight. So we're gonna start with Lee Goddard. Lee serves on the board of directors for Stop Heroin Now. He's a father of an amazing 6-year-old boy and owns and operates a local restaurant. He's a person in long-term recovery from heroin and opiates. Lee has struggled with addiction for the past 20 years, has been in and out of multiple treatment centers and the judicial system prior to finding recovery. Lee was adopted at the age of 3. He's never met his birth parents and as a result always struggled with feelings of abandonment and loneliness. He used drugs and alcohol as a means to escape his feelings and deal with the inner struggles he had regarding his birth. Only now, sober, is he able to finally understand the word unconditional love. Now sober, he knows it was unconditional love from the very day he got off the plane from Seoul, Korea, and met his new family here in America. He feels that because of that unconditional love, he wants to be a better person, a sober person, and he wants to help those in need who continue to struggle with addiction realize the family, the value in family support. Lee Goddard. So we're going to give you 5 minutes to tell anything you want to share about your story. Is that how we're doing it, Ronna?
Okay, so I was adopted at the age of 3. Growing up, I really didn't realize anything different until I was probably like a teenager. I was probably about 11 to 12. And that's where friends would point out, hey, why do you have slanty eyes and your family doesn't, and so forth. And I started to just seek attention from whoever would give it to me. And unfortunately, that was like the wrong peer group that I was able to get attention from. And I kind of settled in with them, and it just kind of steamrolled from there. So when I was 11 years old, my very first time I dabbled in alcohol, I drank a whole bottle of vodka, a liter of vodka. I was probably about 70 pounds. I had to be rushed to the ER. I had to have my stomach pumped. I was in a critical state. I had alcohol poisoning. Well, it just kind of continued from there. You know, my family doesn't have my siblings. I'm the youngest of four, but like nobody really prepped my parents for the road that I was about to take them on. So from there, I was smoking marijuana. It just kind of progressed to I would try anything and anything. From there, I was probably about 13, 14. My family sought refuge in the Worldwide Association of Specialty Programs. So I flew out of the country to Jamaica, and I was there for almost 2 years. And I did a six-step program there where I had to gain my freedom back and, you know, learn the tools to be a productive member back in society. So as I'm going through adolescence, I'm on a completely different country away from my family, and I already had issues of abandonment being adopted. So there's just a lot of stuff that I didn't really deal with, and I learned a lot in Jamaica. And when I came back to the States, I went off to college in Chicago, and I was sober. Like my whole life, I'm 32 now, I would find, you know, spurts of being sober, then I would relapse. Some were worse than others. But it was just a continuation until as pretty recent. I was sober for almost 2 years. This last go around, I relapsed in July. It was a really, really bad relapse. And I end up going to jail. And I'm on probation currently for a felony class 3 extortion charge that I committed in Arizona because of my addiction. And I get off probation in March. So I relapsed in July. I ended up going to jail. I sat in jail for about 6 to 7 days. And I sat in a cell, and I just wanted to get out, and I was, you know, detoxing. But this short time that I've been sober now, I would take that over 2 years, 3 years, 4 years, 5 years of sobriety because of where I'm at today. I think it's kind of, for me, it was a maturity thing. I don't think that if presented the opportunity 5, 6 years ago, I would have actually grasped it. At the age of 32, I have a 6-year-old. It's just different for me now, you know? My family has been there every step of the way. They've never turned their back on me. They've always been there to pick up the pieces and help me out. And I think we all grew during that process. You know, I'm talking 20 years of my family battling addiction with me. And I'm not saying it was like tough love, but I think that we all got to a point that it was just like, hey, you know, things just have to change or this just continues. It doesn't matter if you're 21, you're 15, it's the same thing. It's just you're at a different point in your life. But my story is really long. I can't cram it in 5 minutes, but I'm doing good now. I keep myself busy. That's kind of what I do to focus on my sobriety. I do AODA counseling. I don't need to go to it every week. It's probably one of the things I look forward to most. I go every single week, and I talk for an hour, and it's probably one of my favorite things to do. And I don't think I'll ever give that up. I think that I'm in a position now, I'm extremely busy, where I probably don't need to go every week, but it's something that helps me in my recovery. So I go there, and we talk about all kinds of stuff, but that's something that I do to kind of keep me on the straight and narrow. I stay busy. I'm real active in my family. If you're always in front of people that are going to hold you accountable, that are, you know, looking for your best interest, that's a huge, huge, huge plus. I don't put myself in a situation where I could relapse. I'm not around people that would bring me down. I don't put myself in that position. So, my sister is the president of Stop Heroin Now, and I live with my sister, and she's probably 99% of the reason why I'm at where I'm at today. So that's a huge help too. So you guys are all affected by addiction in some shape or form. And just speaking from my personal experience, you know, like after probably 2, 3, 4, 5 years of dealing with it, you just don't know what to do. My family dealt with it for 20 plus years. And we're better than we ever were. And it gets fixed and things get better. So it's kind of my story in a nutshell. So
thank you. Thank you, Lee. Go down the panel and maybe questions at the end. Okay. So our next guest is Katie Lair Mattis. Katie serves on the board of directors and is the vice president of Stop Heroin Now. She's a certified recovery coach and trainer at Connecticut Community for Addiction Recovery. Katie's the supervisor of the Wisconsin Recovery Coaching State Network pilot. She's the co-founder of Wisconsin Siblings United, as well as the street team coordinator in Washington County for Rise Together. Katie is an AODA therapist and has obtained her AODA degree from MPTC in Fond du Lac. Katie plans to return to college to obtain her bachelor's degree in social work. She's currently employed at Alaris Healthcare Incorporated as a counselor. Katie's passion for this cause has come from her own struggles with addiction. She's just celebrated her 13th year in long-term recovery. She also has a passion not only to save lives, but to educate the community and break the stigma addiction can leave on those who are recovering. Katie.
Well, I was only told that I would have like a minute and I'd introduce myself, but I don't really talk about my story as much. I'm usually the one in the background. I don't like to be up in front, but I kind of did things a lot different. I didn't get addicted to anything until I was in my late 20s. Didn't get clean until after I spent about 2 years locked up. Didn't do groups, didn't do treatment. I wouldn't recommend it. well, no, I wouldn't recommend not going and doing groups. It made it a lot harder for me. But I'm messing with me. Now I'm done. I'm done on that note.
Okay.
No.
All right. All right, our next guest, thank you, Katie. Our next guest is Abe Nerschel. Abe is a person in long-term recovery from heroin. He has been fighting the disease of addiction for over 10 years. His sobriety date is September 20th, 2016. Abe enjoys playing and watching sports and loves spending time umpiring and coaching children in the West Bend Little League Baseball. Abe will be sharing his story of struggles and success in recovery and the road his life took to get to where he is today, in hopes that by educating the public, others will avoid walking in his shoes. Abe.
All right, well, my name is Abe, person in long-term recovery. I guess brief background and addiction, how it has affected me and my loved ones. I started smoking marijuana and drinking in high school, well, freshman year, and progressed all the way through high school, started losing interest in sports, things along that, and was more focused on partying, having fun, or so I thought, and doing that. And I left to go away for college after high school and was introduced to painkillers, using painkillers for about a year, and that quickly turned into heroin use. And my addiction to heroin, you know, it took me places I never thought I would go. Been in jail, prison numerous times, numerous overdoses, and it turned me into someone that I wasn't. Started stealing, broke into my own parents' house, stole from them, which ended up sending me back to prison, and been through numerous treatments, and I never was ready to change. I didn't. It was like Bob mentioned earlier, I thought I knew how to fix it and I could do it myself, and I wouldn't let anyone in to help me. I thought I had all the answers, and it went on for about 10 years, and the constant struggles and battles of fighting with people because I didn't want their help at the time. And so right now I'm currently at the Exodus House, which is a halfway house in Kewaskum. My last relapse was on the 19th of September of 2016. And I went into jail, and my probation officer was willing to, and there were other people involved that helped me get to a treatment. I went out to Nova and Oshkosh, did a 28-day program there, and I came to Exodus House. And my experience with that has been a success. I have let people in my life, and I have accepted their help. And now I have a program that I follow, and I don't have all the answers today, and I'm okay with that, because when I don't have the answers, I can ask other people, and other people can grab my hand and walk me through this battle, because it's a battle every day. But if I let those people that want to help and the good people around me in to help me, I can make it through the day sober. So I just have to keep telling myself that I don't know, and I'm okay with that, and I can have other people help me. So
thank you, Abe. Our next guest is Melissa Doherty. Melissa states when she went from an honor student to a ruthless, reckless, selfish, drug addicted person to a sober, carefree, loving mother of two. She started her addiction with opiate painkillers and then progressed her disease to heroin when the painkillers became too expensive and not available. She found herself to be deceiving, lying, and manipulating. She was involved in a very nasty car accident and an 18-month prison stay. This she attributes to opening her eyes, and she found recovery. If you spoke with her today, she will be the first to tell you that it is by the grace of God that she is clean and sober. Melissa.
Well, hello, I'm an addict named Melissa, and I used to be the most carefree person in the world when I was younger. I had a very dysfunctional family because I had a split family where I had good and I had evil. My dad is an alcoholic addict, and he still struggles to this day. My mom and stepdad are blessings to me. They have shown me unconditional love no matter what. It wasn't until 2010 when I dropped out of UW-Milwaukee, which I was going for dental, because I thought a 3.8 was horrible. That's when I was starting to use drugs. I tampered with pills here and there because I wanted to escape all the stress of life. I didn't want to deal with it. I didn't start because I was prescribed. I started because I was curious. As time went on, pills got more expensive, harder to find, so I switched to heroin. Snorted heroin for quite some time before I thought intravenous would be better. I have track marks up and down my arms that are a reminder to me that I need to stay strong. I had 3 different stays in inpatient, which only allowed me to stay for 4 days at a time and get Suboxone because my insurance would not cover it. Of course, I went out and used again. That's what you do. You get Suboxone and you don't get any treatment, so that's what I did. I went back to using. I had D DPA after DPA, which is deferred prosecution agreement, meaning if I completed those successfully, I would not become a felon. I was lucky enough to have three of those, one right after the other, not even a week after I committed another crime and was put on them. It wasn't until May 14th, 15th, where I got in a car accident with my 8-month-old daughter in the back seat. I overdosed behind the wheel, I hit a fire hydrant, a tree, and I flipped my car. I've had numerous overdoses, and that still didn't seem to stop me, because when I was sitting in the back of that ambulance, I thought, oh, well, they're not going to find out I'm on probation, and I'm going to be able to go home and use. I almost killed myself and my daughter that day. I called my mom, complaining, get me out, I don't deserve to be here. I was in denial, clear denial. I didn't know what to do. I was thinking, I'm going to get out. This is okay. This is how it works. You know, I've been through this. Judgment day came where I went to court, and I got sentenced to 18 months in prison. The DA asked for 9 months. That's double what they originally asked for. I'm grateful each and every day that I went to prison, because it helped open my eyes. It wasn't until about 4 months into my prison stay that I actually realized I had a problem, a huge problem. And it was the fact that I almost killed my baby, and I thought I was going to be able to use 5 hours later. So I'm grateful that I'm here today. I've been clean for 2 years and 9 months, and I'd like to say 3 years, but who knows? You have to take it one day at a time. I will do everything in my power to stay clean just that one day, because you're not given the next day. You only are promised today. Thank you.
Thank you, Melissa. Our next presenter is April Weary. April has been in long-term recovery from alcohol and opiates since March 26, 2015. April is currently a student at Moraine Park Technical College in Fond du Lac in the AODA program. She is completing her internship currently at Affiliated Clinical Services and aspires to be a clinical substance abuse therapist while obtaining her master's degree. April is very involved in the NAAA community and facilitates her own AA meetings on Sundays in Dodge County. April is a mom to her amazing son, Lincoln, who is 3 years old. Lincoln was born addicted to opiates, and April she's made it her goal to ensure other mothers who struggle with the disease of addiction or are pregnant get help for their addiction. That's her top priority for that unborn child. April Weary.
Hey, kind of like Katie in that, I'm not much for public speaking, but so my story kind of starts when I was 15. I started drinking and smoking pot. It really escalated when I was 16 years old. I had to have a double jaw surgery, or jaw joint, so on both sides of my jaw. And for over a year, I was prescribed pain medication. And it's no excuse that being prescribed it, because I did start to abuse it. And it led me into getting them off the street, and just progressing further and further. I pretty much every time I went to the doctor, I could get prescribed them, just because I have a history of ulcers, so they'll prescribe them if you're not able to take regular NSAIDs. And so I kept using that, and then would deny that I had a problem because they were prescribed, and started hanging out with friends that used, and just kept going down that road. And I've been in treatment 3 different times. The first one, I didn't complete it or stay sober that long. It was about 6 months, and I relapsed quickly because I still thought. I still thought that I could drink, and So I thought, you know, oh, I just have a problem with pills, and I can drink, it'll be fine, not a big deal, which led me to relapse. The second time I sought treatment was when I found out I was pregnant. And it was actually very hard for me to get into treatment. I tried finding treatment when I found out I was pregnant, and I was probably in my towards the end of my second month or beginning of third month before I actually began a treatment program, and it was with Affiliated that Dr. Kumar was willing to take me on as a client. And I, from what I've heard, things have changed, but access to services when you're pregnant was not easy. And I don't know if it's just this county or if doctors didn't want the liability or what, but I was very lucky to be taken on and as a client and to be able to go through that program. So throughout my pregnancy, I was taking a medication called Subutex, which even though I weaned down on it, my son was still born with neonatal abstinence syndrome. And it's basically, he was born addicted to Subutex, which is a form of an opiate. It's, you know, it would have been a lot worse for him had I not been in treatment and using that medication compared to if I was still, you know, using heavily the pills that I was using. So I was in the NICU with him for 2 weeks, and I barely left. I was able to stay overnight with him, and I stayed sober for about the first year of my son's life. The mistake I made is that I didn't work a recovery program. I believed all I needed was my son to keep me sober. That after going through that and watching that, there was no possible way I could ever use again. That, you know, that would keep me sober, just remembering that. And that's when I learned how powerful addiction is, because when my son was about a year old is when I relapsed. And it was due to injury, and going to the doctor and being offered pain medication, and because I was not working a program, I didn't have the strength to say no. And that is when it got its worst. Addiction's a progressive disease, and I got to the point where I relapsed for about 4 months. It was worse than probably all my time combined when I was using. I spent $5,000 in 1 month. I'm very, very lucky that I did not end up in the legal system. I very easily could have. And the third time I went to treatment was when I was given the ultimatum of go to treatment or your child's going to be taken away. I couldn't bear that thought. And so I went to treatment where I was able to go into a dual diagnosis program, partial hospitalization, and was there for about 2.5 weeks. But the difference was that I continued after I got home. You know, I kept going to meetings, became involved in the AA community and NA community. I got involved in service work and kept my recovery a priority, because if I don't keep my recovery a priority in my life, nothing else that I do matters. I wouldn't be a good mom. I wouldn't be in school. You know, all of those things that as you have more time in sobriety that become part of your life, if you let them take too much and you don't keep your recovery a priority, I found you can just lose them all. And so today I'm very happy to be where I'm at, and each day I do everything I can to stay strong in my recovery and to continue to grow and to educate others. So.
Thank you, April. Our next presenter is Tina Perry. Tina is the founder and director of Just Listen, a program designed to provide healthy outlets and activities for those from all walks of life and age groups. Tina believes that whether you are struggling with addiction, emotional issues, or just looking for ways to become, or are just looking for some way to become involved with your community, Just Listen can help. Tina is also a person in long-term recovery and has been sober for the past 30 years. She has turned her recovery into a passion to help others live a sober lifestyle. Tina is a certified recovery coach at Connecticut Community for Addiction Recovery and is also a parent of a person who struggles with the disease of addiction, Tina Perry.
Hi, thank you. The video you've seen tonight was a little bit of my life relived. I am in my 30th year of recovery from cocaine, and I am the daughter of an alcoholic. Sorry, I break sometimes. Self, and a parent of a heroin addict. So what I did was, when my daughter started having issues with substance abuse, I realized it was time to bring my own story out because I believe through that you could help others. So what I did was take from when I went to recovery and thought about all the things I enjoyed, the things I did not enjoy, and I put it all together to try and figure out what could be possible to help people get through their addictions in a positive way and to continue every day. So that's what I did. And today, currently, for my child, it's always harder to help your own child, but I'm a champion at helping others. My daughter got out of prison in May of 2016, went back into jail November 2016, and is currently there right now going back to prison from just getting out of a 2-year prison sentence. So recovery is different for everybody. We never know what it's going to take for that person to change their life, but it is possible, and never give up hope. And currently today, Just Listen has 5 links. We have a Sprout link, which is 2 to 5-year-olds, a Junior link, which is kindergarten through 8th grade, a Teen link, which is high school students, Community link is for all community involvement, and then we have recovery coaching, and I have a great board and a great team. And so the reason I say all these links is because we're trying to teach the young ones and the youth how very important it is for self-value, coping skills, because even when we are youth, we have things to cope with. We see things all around that are not good, that are good, and how do we get through these days growing up? And so me and my team and partners and Stop Heroin Now and Rise Together is another group. There's a lot of different groups out there that we're all teaming up doing the same thing differently. So we're hoping to teach these young children their self-values, coping skills, and all the good things to do and outlets what they do so they don't get to that recovery side. And the ones that need recovery, we're doing the best that we can to possibly help them for learning about themselves, how their addiction came about, and finding new ways within themselves of things that maybe they want to do differently, something that they wanted to do a long time ago. And let's bring it back. What are things you thought of that you've never done that you still want to do? And what we do at Just Listen is give all different options, painting to express yourself, and just a lot of things that they find themselves loving their new life. And they know that we're always here by a phone call, a text, an email, and honestly, every form of communication can save a life. A little text message, just knowing somebody's there. Our office, our phone number, to knock on the door. We have recovery support group meetings for addicts, for friends and families of addicts, and for goal setting. So today I'm proud to be here and thank everyone for allowing me to be here and thankful for all these other groups that do what we do, because all of us together partnering and showing the community, we are proof there is hope. Never give up and always be there. We have all our information all over and we support each other. If you call any of our groups, we definitely have an offer of another phone number if you need some other type of help. So thank you for listening and thank you for all you do.
Thank you. With all of that candor from the seven of you and the strength that they showed, I think I'm sitting here thinking that it's probably hypocritical for me not to just tell you a little bit of my story related to addiction as well. I was not planning on this, but when Bob broke the ice there and the six of you were so strong and brave, I'm in my eighth year of struggling with an addiction in our family, not myself personally, but prescription drugs and alcohol ruined my family over the last 8 years. We tried the 3 years of an unconditional love. That didn't work. We tried now the last 5 years of the tough love because we didn't know what else to do. So now I had my children placed with me the last 5 years by Washington County full time because their mother just struggled. She couldn't get on top of it. And the county stepped in and just placed them with me because it destroyed our marriage and destroyed our family. Lovely woman who was raised by an alcoholic herself, but her mother drank herself to death at 42. And she was sober until the age of 20, 28, 29, and then all of a sudden it just snuck up on her and took over our married and family life. And so I guess, you know, the bottom line is I just feel like no matter who we are, I think there's some strand of it that can touch you when you least expect it. Even if you think you're on top of it and think you're tough enough to do it alone, I think that what we've learned through my ex-wife's journey is that you just have to stay true to that therapeutic process. Sometimes those prison or jail stays are the lifesavers, truly. Michelle just got out of jail 2 weeks ago, and last night we had our first family event together in over 2 years of my son's band concert at Slinger High School because we're trying to bring her back into the mix and allow her to be a mom again. And so I don't know where this will go, but we're not going to give up on her. We're strong in our faith. And strong in our belief in her, but I don't have the answer. Unconditional love, tough love, I think it's a balance of both, and each individual has their own work to do and their own journey and own formula of what it'll take, I think, as well. But I can't say enough about the strength of these panelists to share their story, and I guess that's what my kids and I have decided is that kind of our mission is to try to relate to other kids. I work in the school district. I'm not shy about sharing it with kids who are going through a tough time, regardless of what role I've had in Slinger. My daughter's actually she's a freshman at Concordia, and she's facilitating support groups for teens whose parents have addiction issues, and they're coping with their parents' addiction. So we're trying to keep it in the family, make an impact that way, and hope that we can make our small difference in our world too. So again, appreciate causes like this, because it's only through the sharing and leaning on each other, I think, that we can get on top of this. So any questions for any of the panelists as we wrap up our evening?
I was on the Vivitrol shot for about a year. So my third time in treatment, I had to go through my withdrawal at home before I went into treatment because I was put on a 3-week waiting list. So when I went into treatment, because I was already, you know, clean, I didn't want to go on Suboxone. So I chose to do the Vivitrol shot, and I was on it for a year.
And what were some of the side effects? What were, did you feel? A big contributor? Did you?
I definitely think it helped. You know, it's partially like for your own mental, you know, like a security blanket, like you know you can't use or that there's no point to use because it won't work. And I do think it helped with cravings and everything.
can I ask you, the insurance cover it? Did you?
My insurance did cover it, but not all insurances do. And when they don't, it's around like $1,000 sometimes.
So that's my understanding for Bob Gannon. Bring me to the place. These kids want to go to get help. They want to go to ACL, or they want to go to where you are, Alexa, or whatever. The cost is outrageous. Half these kids don't have insurance. They don't have jobs. They're full-time parents. Very small jobs. $1,200. Some insurances don't cover it. You guys want to help these kids? Give her the cost. I mean, I'm going to tell you, my daughter is a heroin addict, and she's been through the program. She's in treatment right now, inpatient. It's frustrating because it takes a lot, and these kids can't get it. You talk about unconditional love, you talk about tough love. As a parent, it is the hardest thing you would ever have to do. But you guys want help. You have to be able to make it affordable for these kids. You have to make it doable so that they can come there. And the second thing is, my daughter went to ACF or ACLS or whatever. Just Suboxone, just another drug. But, and Dr. Kumar, you can't do that like that. So
these programs that you think that these kids are really getting something out of, they're not. I know a girl that just died, Jamie Sable, maybe some of you know her here. She went to these programs. She used to strap an IV bag on her to pass her P test at your programs. The DOC has the POC, or their probation officers watch them. So there's more accountability. And these programs, they don't have that. So really, what's the benefit? Where are these kids getting the help that they need?
Morgan. Okay, my name is Jessica Geschke, and I'm the director of AODA services at Affiliated Clinical Services, as known as ACS. So I do apologize, and I feel for you. I get where your frustrations are coming from. First of all, for those of you who do not know what Vivitrol is, it's a once-a-month injection that's an opiate inhibitor, blocks opiates from entering the brain, the part of your brain that wants narcotics, okay, or heroin. Is it expensive for Vivitrol? Yes, it is. But do we work with people that want to get on Vivitrol? Yes. We do have copay cards in the amount of $550 that we can give people. Insurance does cover Vivitrol. Medicaid covers Vivitrol. So in most cases, I have never once had a patient where insurance does not cover it, and I've been doing this for 13 years. As far as our Suboxone programs at Affiliated or anywhere, I mean, I can talk as far as Alaris too. I don't want to speak for Alaris, but I do work with Katie. She's my VP for our nonprofit. And so the Suboxone programs are very strict. I don't know what your issues are with Dr. Kumar per se, but I run that program. And so if people come into our facility with fake pee, I'm mandated not to go into those bathrooms. Like, I cannot do that. It's unethical for me to go in and watch somebody urinate. They can do that in the DOC because they can do that. They're not treatment providers. So if your children come into our facilities with fake pee on them, I can't do anything about it. What I can do and what I do, because I'm a pretty tough therapist, if those of you who do know me and have kids that come to our facility, I mean, I will literally stand outside the door and listen to make sure that I do not hear containers opening, bags opening. And if I do, Katie used to be our lab tech there. She will go in and she will check for those things. Mm-hmm. We do the best that we can. We aren't about saving lives in this, or in organizations. I don't want your kids to die. We try and do every single thing possible. But if they bring in fake pee, like, I check the temperatures. We check it. Sometimes we have people who give us urine that's 115 degrees. I know that didn't come out of them or they would be dead. So, we try it. We call families. We do, as much as we can. But we do as much as we can. Like, we're only human. So it happens. In our Suboxone program, Dr. Kumar, like, they're giving it out like candy. We give one-week scripts. So if that's what we do. One-week scripts, they have to be in group or they can't get their next week's script. That's our policy there, and it's been the policy since I started the program. She knows it. I know there's other people in this room who are also my patients that would know that. So I don't know, and we can talk afterwards if you have any other, you know, questions about that. But as far as Vivitrol, if you guys want to get on Vivitrol, or if there's people who you know that want Vivitrol, you can come to me afterwards, and I can help you kind of navigate and facilitate through that.
And I would just like to add that, yes, I've done the Vivitrol, but I also have been in Suboxone programs, and I don't know that my son would be here if I wasn't in a program that I had taken Subutex, because I could have miscarried or gone into premature labor, if I had gone through withdrawal. Because people should know, too, that with the Vivitrol, you can't get that shot until you at least have 7 days without opiates in your system. And that includes Suboxone, which can be very difficult for people to go from, and wean off of to do the Vivitrol shot. So, there's what works for people is always different. And, the Vivitrol shot helped me, but it was different circumstances that led me to doing that. And I have done the other programs as well.
I just feel the Vivitrol shot should be strongly more encouraged than the Suboxone.
Yep.
Just because
there's deviation with Suboxone. Total deviation. Suboxone is worth money on the street. Vivitrol is worth nothing.
Right.
So, I mean, I have Vivitrol all day long. Yeah.
I'd like to just make a comment here about can you hear
the power of addiction and the ability to beat the system. I'm not the smartest guy in the room, but I could drink and people wouldn't know I was drinking. So until somebody has made that decision to change their life, they can beat any system, whether it's pee dripping down their leg out of a bag or there's 101 ways we can beat a drug test. So I truly believe, and I just want to remind you, that we have to change their minds and their hearts and make them want to get clean. Because an addict, some of the smartest people I know are addicts and alcoholics, because they have the ability to beat every system, whether it's from stealing to get the money to pay for the drugs or to trick their family into thinking they're clean. And I love you all, and I know your hearts are in the right place, but you got to stay tough, man.
Another comment? Yeah.
I just want to say congratulations to all you guys up there. That's awesome for staying clean.
I do have one quick question. Is it possible, I know somebody had commented, I think last week, about getting drugs in prison. Is it possible in jail too?
I'm afraid so.
Okay.
And again, I'm talking a firsthand account from my ex-wife, who's back out now, and she's telling stories about in her Washington County jail experience just the last 2 weeks. It's quite frequent that it happens, that it's available.
Because I know, like, a lot of my friends' kids have no contact, like, with outside contact. They only talk through, like, a TV monitor. So are they coming in through...
My understanding, what I got from her, is that it's the Huber release people that are able to sneak it back in.
But they don't have contact with the prisoners. Do you know what I'm saying? Like in Milwaukee County Jail?
Oh, I see. Yeah, I don't.
I didn't.
Bob's Custard brought in to me by a CO.
By a CO?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. I'm just curious, like, how they're getting them in the jails. I can figure out the prison, but.
I got cheesecake. I got colored pencils. You know, you can get anything if you know the right person to talk to and to. I guess.
I have a 9-year-old that, and I just have a lot of friends who this is affecting their children, and trying to talk to them and convince them that this is going to happen or could happen to your kids, and they don't get it. And it's happened to some of them already, and they just don't understand. They think being in jail is safe, and I don't think it is.
I mean, it goes both ways. I mean, it can be. And, I mean, there's instances where it's not going to be. I don't think I would probably be exactly where I am if I wasn't locked up.
Right.
And had to sit and think, well, what do I really, do I want to keep doing this? I want to be out. I want to have sunlight and be with my family. I don't want to keep doing this. So unless you're ready, it's not going to happen anyway. So.
Right.
Any other comments as we wind up? All right, so I want to encourage you that the hidden in plain sight bedroom exhibit, oh, I'm sorry.
That's okay.
Yeah?
I was wondering when people are in treatment and then they relapse and go to another treatment, does the person that's in there for help, does it make a difference with who they connect with, do you think? More impressionable, or is it all up to the client, if I'm explaining myself well? You know, when you go in and you talk to someone and they try to help you, sometimes maybe you don't connect.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
I think so, is that why some people relapse maybe and go to another treatment, or?
I don't know about necessarily relapse, but through my different treatment programs, I can honestly say that my relationship with my therapist now, that is, it's real and it's honest, and it's, I get that because there is a connection between, you know, our relationship. And I drive quite a, like an hour out of my way from where I live to go there because, and I've been offered to go more locally, but I won't break that relationship because it's key if you're comfortable with that individual, you know. It's more real for me.
Right.
You know.
It's like your best friend, maybe.
Right.
You know. Thank you.
All right, so the hidden in plain sight bedroom exhibit is still open until 8 p.m., so I want to encourage you to look at that. And then there's one more series next week, February 23rd, and that's a heroin simulation. You'll have the opportunity to observe how destructive heroin is on the body through a health education simulation. So that is next February 23rd. And as we wrap up, Ron?
I think everybody in the panel is going to be out.
Our panelists are going to be mingling out in the lobby if you want to talk to any of them. If any of their stories connected you personally, sounds like they're going to make themselves available to you. And we thank them again for the continued honesty and candor about their experience so we can all grow together. So thank you for attending tonight.
So before we head out, for you guys up here, Ron and I just wanted to thank you from the bottom of our hearts. We have some flowers for you. We know how tough it is in society today to be in recovery. I think society in general tells us to dislike people that are in recovery, to discount them. And so we just wanted to say thank you for coming out and sharing your story. Katie, really? and sharing your stories with us, because it's great to learn new things from people. And I know personally, like I'm trying to give a heartfelt story here. personally, I know each and every one of you guys on this panel, and I asked you guys to be here for a reason, and it's because you have all given something to me of yourselves. And with Ron and I both working so hard on the task force and day in and day out doing what we do here, we can get extremely discouraged by the number of deaths in this county that we see. And I think just being able to refresh ourselves every now and then with stories of recovery and seeing you guys, you lead by example and you help us each day come back every single day to our jobs. And you give us that hope and that inspiration that we need to keep going and keep moving, because some days I tell you we don't want to come here. We don't want to come back. And so we just really want you guys to know how important you are to society, to this community, and to us. So thank you so much. And if there's anyone in this audience that's in recovery, could you please stand? And that includes you guys. Because I know you're out there. So thank you. Can you, everyone, give them a hand. Thank you so much, guys.